power be unto him who sits on a throne, my God. Let's sing an honor, glory and power be unto him who sits on a throne. Sits on a throne, my God. Yeah. Thank I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be than here in your love, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be, here in your love, here in your love, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be, here in your love, here in your love. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Down in my soul.
church. In Jeremiah 29:11, it says, For alone I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Thoughts and plans of welfare and peace and not of evil, to give you a hope and a final outcome. See, some of us have been lied to. Some of us have been deceived. And the scripture says, it goes on and further on, it says, if you seek for me, if you require me with all your heart and search for me, you will find me. And the scripture says in the song, we're listening to the music right now, and it says, if you seek me with all your heart, you will find me. That he'll set us on fire on the inside. That is his heart. That is his plan for us. That as we seek him, as we inquire of him, as we desire him, that he will show up. He's already asking for it. That is already his heart. His heart is already saying, come to me and you will be filled. I have a good expectancy for you. I have a good outcome for you. Don't receive what the devil has given you. Don't receive where you are right now. Don't receive the lies that you've been given. But step in, step in. I want to set you on fire that you can go to a new level, that you can walk in that what I have for you. Don't listen to the lies anymore. Step in and set those hearts on fire. Let your soul burn from the inside for me, and you will find me, and you will find me, and I will meet you there in Jesus' name.
Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. Passion for his name, for his name.
Church, I just want to lift up two prayer requests. Linda and Mark had a friend who went to be with the Lord this morning after fighting cancer. So we want to pray right now for comfort of the Holy Spirit in that situation, in that friendship with the family. We don't know everything. We don't have the answers to everything. But one thing we do know is the Holy Spirit is the comforter. And we ask right now, Holy Spirit, that you would comfort the situation, that you would comfort even understanding, Lord, where we try and rationalize you, God. But Lord, we pray right now. We pray right now for a peace in that situation. And we pray for Jim and Jan. Jim, right now where you are, we speak life over that is coming against you. Sickness and disease does not belong. We rebuke it. We denounce it right now. And we take authority in the blood of Jesus right now. And we thank you that you were healed 2,000 years ago. And that sickness has no room in this. Sickness has no room in this. Sickness is a name, and every name and knee will bow down right now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Church, I want us to sing that song one more time. I just don't feel God's released us yet from that song. I don't feel it. I think some people are holding back, and God is saying, no, I want you to give everything. I want you to give everything. And as we sing it again, I want you to forget about the person next to you. I want you to forget about the weather. I want you to forget about the washing that you forgot out before you came and it's getting wet and you have to wash it again. I want you to forget about all of those things. And I want you just to commit to the Lord. I want you to come before Him. I want you to visualize right now that you're at the throne of God and that He's sitting there, the life, the one that gave you life, the one that breathed life into you, the one that knew you before you formed in your mother's womb. that very one there. I want you to give everything to Him in prayer, in supplication, in song, that He can move us forward and release us to go forward this morning. Just one more time. One more time.
No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. Hearing Your love. Hearing Your love. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. Hearing Your love. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of You, God. I want more of You, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of You, God. I want more.
Thank You right now, Lord. I thank You, Father, that as we come to You this morning, Lord, as we come to You with open hearts, for more of You, Father, less of us. More of You, less of us. More of You, less of us. We thank You that we're open to receive Your word, that we're open to receive more of You this morning, Lord. And we thank You, Lord, that every time we have an encounter with You, we go out changed, and that we can grow, and that we can bring Thy kingdom come to earth as it is in heaven. We thank You, Father. Bless this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, why don't you turn around and say something to someone. Be nice. Do we have any first-time visitors in the house? First-time visitors. This is not an auction. It's just a question. Any first-time visitors? Jim, please can somebody get Jim a welcome pack? Thanks, John. Right here, the gentleman in the front. No one else? Awesome. Well, I'm going to pass over to Lee to do announcements. We've got about 500. And then Jim... he's going to preach a sermon on offerings.
Make sure you tell the new person about missions department. It's really good. I'll go through announcements, the 500 announcements. Not quite, but... because we need to give Jim 20 minutes if he's doing the offering. New people, anyone who's joined the church who's now calling HFCC home, may have been coming the last month or so. Every month, we've started giving out or asking you to fill in one of these forms. They're available on the information desk. This is so we can keep some details on you, so we can pastor you, we can look after you, we know who you are, and we can help you. If you changed your details in the last month, this is the best way to let us know. We send a lovely birthday card when it's your birthday. We'd love to send you a birthday card to say happy birthday. So please fill that out. There's an online form coming soon as well. But really, we want to know who you are. If HFCC is your home, and this is a place you come on a Sunday where you feel spiritually fed, we want to know who you are. So please fill that in. Available from the information desk. See one of the pastors. We'll get you one of these. So please stay in touch. As I mentioned last week, we're holding our first DNA course for the year. This was the four-week preaching sermon we did back in February after Vision Sunday. This is the full-blown extended version of it. It's on a Thursday night at 7 p.m., starting Thursday the 19th of May, and we're going through those eight pillars that we talked about in Vision Sunday. It's going to be a great time. If you're new to the church, this is really good for you to get to know what the heartbeat of HFCC is. And if you've been in the church for years and you think you know what it is, come along and still find out, because I bet you'll learn something. So get your name down. I don't think we're limiting numbers, but get your name down just in case they happen to cut it off. You don't want to miss out. We will be running it twice in the year. So if you can't make it in May, there will be another one later on in the year. It's a wonderful English summer's day today, isn't it? Yes! May, it should have nice, beautiful weather. It shouldn't be too hot. We're going to do something different with our Church Connect in May. On Sunday the 22nd of May, we're going to the Botanical Gardens in Ashmore. After church, I think it's about 12:30, we're going to get there. I'd love you all to join us there. Bring chairs, pillows, blankets, whatever. Bring games, ball games, whatever. We're going to have a lot of fun. The church is going to provide drinks and desserts. There's some maps on the information desk. Bring along some food. I think there's some barbecues there. We can barbecue up something or something like that, you know. English people don't barbecue really, because it's that one day of sun a year. They go to the beach. Just don't. And who knows that Brother Jerry is coming in June. Yes. It's the Great Breaking Loose Conference from Friday the 24th of June to Sunday the 26th of June. There's five meetings over these 3 days. You should have received one of Brother Jerry's partner letters on the way in. This is a really great message that Brother Jerry puts together. Fantastic. Thanks, Lynn. One of these. If you haven't got it, get a copy of it. In this church, you hear a lot about Brother Jerry, but how much do you really know about Brother Jerry? Over these coming weeks, we're going to play you some short clips and that starting next week of who Brother Jerry really is, so you can understand him. If you've never heard Brother Jerry preach before, you need to get here in June. And listening to these clips, I'm sure you're going to want to. You're going to really hear the heart of this man. He preaches on favor, faith and grace, and you want to be here. So really, we want to introduce you to him. He's been in ministry for 45 years. How many people can say that, 45 years? We know he's going to truly bless you, so make sure you put that in your diary to come here, to be here. Also, as we were mentioning, we're looking for people also to help people get here on those meetings. We've got a lot of people flying in from all over Australia. There's partners of the ministry that want to come and see Brother Jerry. This is the only place that he's preaching in Australia this year. Sometimes when he comes, he's able to fly down to Melbourne and Sydney and that. Unfortunately, fortunately for us, he's doing 3 days with us and he's not going anywhere else. So people are flying from all over. So they're staying in hotels from Broadbeach up to Burleigh, up to Palm Beach. And we want some help to get these people to us to those meetings. Also, if you want to get involved and you want to serve in those meetings, we need people to serve, especially Kids Church. I hear they're needing a few more people to help out in Kids Church because we're providing Kids Church over that time. So if you feel called to look after kids and want to look after kids in that time, please put your name down at the information desk. Okay, Lance, are you ready with that 20-minute clock? You sure? Because Pastor Ian's not here. Do you reckon Jim can do 20 minutes? Yeah!
Could I have the lights down, please? This is one of my favourite topics. It's not about me, but it's money. We talk about it to each other. We talk about it at service stations. We talk about it at shopping centres. We talk about it everywhere, sometimes good, sometimes not so good. But money in the right hands can do a lot. And I just want to show you this little clip. This is from what you guys have been giving in the last couple of months has made this possible. Thanks, Chloe. Is that awesome or what? So money in the right hands does an awful lot. Well, not an awful lot, but does a great lot. So I've put a slide up there just to let you know where you are today. And one of the new ones on the right-hand side, halfway down, you'll see some people there with some signs. And there, that's a little village in India. It's 27 and a half hours drive. Would the ushers please come forward? But just before they do, when you place your gift in, would you release it? Just release it into God's care. Release it into God's care. Please come. So this little village in India, 27 and a half hours drive south of the capital, New Delhi, we bought them some sewing machines. It was $200 each. Now, this changed the family's income from $2.15 a day to $15 an hour. They were able to make clothes for themselves. They were able to sell those clothes on. People were able to then sell those clothes on. So it became a whole new infrastructure. And I said to God, I said, Lord, this is your 3 minutes. What do you want me to say? And the Lord said, just tell the people, thank you, because today you're in Israel. Today you're in Thailand. Today you're in Africa on mercy ships. Today you're in New Guinea. Today you're putting fuel in the chariots' bikes. Today you're in the Ukraine gathering God's people home. Today you're helping the abused children on the Gold Coast, the abused women for the Hope Foundation. Today you are in all those places. Would you like to come forward? So what we see as money when we release it into God's hands, it becomes life, it becomes hope. So you just extend your hands towards us as we pray. Father, we thank you. What a privilege and an honor it is to give to you, Lord God, and it continues the cycle, and it will change lives. We thank you for that change in people's lives. We thank you for the love, the hope, and the life it's bringing. And according to your word, we thank you for that cycle, Father God, that will continue, that you will bring further finances into our hands so that we can continue this ministry, that through us all the nations of the earth will be blessed. We give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Don't you find that the band, God is doing something in the band, the anointing is increasing? You see, where teamwork and unity flow, God commands a blessing, and that's what's happening. So well done, guys. Hey? Sorry, I beg your pardon. Good morning to you on live stream. Welcome, welcome, welcome to you, family. I just want to say it was Mum's 60th birthday this week. So everybody is here, give her a good kiss and a hug. And I bought her a 30th birthday card, but Megan reminded me that she is actually 60. So anyway, hey, I want to talk about something and deal with something this morning. Something that annoys me. It's called the spirit of fear. The devil didn't want me delivering this message this week. You don't know what I've went through this week to get here this morning. Okay? There's some messages he doesn't mind in church. It's okay. It's not a threat to him. But when you start coming against his weapons, his arsons, okay? There's something he hates. Because when you dismantle his strategies, when you expose his structures, okay, you take his power away. And today I want to talk about that. But before I get into the crux of what God was showing me is how to overcome the spirit of fear, I just want to share a few stories quickly. And I'm going to jump around. And those of you that know me, I don't do things according to theology and Bible school and seminaries and all that. That says four scriptures plus two plus this. I don't do that. I talk as God leads me, and as I put a sermon together, it's based on what God wants, amen? So I don't do things like that, and it's okay. But I want to take you to a story in the book of Numbers, chapter 13, 26 to 33. It's got to do with the spies that went out to go and check out the land. They went to go and have a look at, hey, God said centuries ago, generations ago, I'm going to give you this. Okay, and they were there. They were at this place. They were at this place where they were in reach. Have you ever been there where it's like, it's so close? It's like so close, okay? It's like they actually had a piece of it. They actually tasted it. They actually tangibly touched it, okay? And I want to share a few things with you quickly. It says, now they departed and came back to Moses and Aaron and all the congregation of the children of Israel in the wilderness at Kadesh. They brought back word to them. Now this is important. They brought back word to them and all the congregation and showed the fruit. They showed the fruit of the land. Everyone say opportunity and destiny. Then they told him and said, we went to the land where you sent us. It truly flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. In other words, great idea. Good business opportunity, great market, the ministry is ripe, the people are ready to go. You're getting what they're saying? Nevertheless, the people who dwell in the land are strong. The cities are fortified and very large. Moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, the Hittites and the Jebusites, and the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea, and along the banks of the Jordan. Then Caleb quieted the people. Okay? What he did is he took their anxieties, He took their doubts, he took their unbelief and tried to shut it up. That's what he did straight away because he saw what Satan was trying to do. Before Moses and said, let us go up at once. Now this is a man with a different spirit. Listen, if you want to occupy and walk in the fullness of what God has for you, you need a different spirit. You cannot be placid and you need to be tenacious. What's the word? Tenacity. You need tenacity. Tenacious. You need to be like a pit bull. Okay? That's the type of spirit you need. And that's what he was doing. Yeri comes. You got the negative report. And he's like, shut up. I'm going. Who's with me? Two. Don't laugh. God might share something this week and tell you to walk into it. Don't laugh yet. I haven't got finished preaching. So he says, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. Listen, Caleb had a different spirit. He was looking through different lenses. And these people said, we cannot go up against it. Now you must get the context. God promised them. He gave them a word. He said, go, I'm going to give it to you. Yeah, they get to it. It's in reach. And he says, we can't go up against them. Listen, if you're going to spend 40 years going towards something God's told you to do, and you get in reach of it, and you decide it's too hard, you need your head read. You just waited 40 years of your life. Amen? That's what happened here. Bottom line, it goes down and says, we saw giants, and we were like grasshoppers in our own sight. So, they didn't say that you are a grasshopper. They perceived we were inferior. We didn't have the ability. We could not go and possess. Nothing was articulated to them. They were just perceiving things through the enemy seeds that were getting planted on their head. You see, a journey that should have taken 11 days took 40 years. God's promise was at hand and in reach. Okay? But what happened? Fear and doubt crept in. Fear and doubt crept in. You see, every time God will give you a word, Satan will send his best enemy against you. And one of his best enemies, one of his best weapons is fear. Because fear will paralyze you from walking into that what God has for you. Amen? Strong in spirit. Everyone say strong in spirit.
Strong in spirit.
You need to be strong in spirit to go occupy when God gives you a God-given vision. I'm not talking man's idea. I'm talking when you have a God-given birth inside of you. It is far bigger than you can achieve ever, even in your lifetime sometimes. But you have to be strong in spirit and stand against all the opposition. And fear is the very thing that will nullify and short-circuit your faith. And I'm going to show you a few things. I want to share another story in 1 Samuel. We all know this. This is Saul's first encounter, well, one of his encounters against Goliath. They had been in battle and being tormented for about 40 days. Okay? Listen what happens. This is Goliath speaking. He says, if he is able to fight me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him, listen, intimidation's coming. Look here. If I prevail against him and kill him, and then you shall be our servants and serve us. And the Philistine said, I defy the armies of Israel this day. Give me a man that will fight together. Okay? Can you see the spirit of intimidation coming? The root of that spirit is fear. If you have fear in your life, intimidation will always be there. Always be there. And look what he says. When Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. They were dismayed and greatly afraid. If you look at that word in the dictionary, it says struck with fear. It says fearful. It's basically you're struck with fear. It's like you're paralyzed. Like fear hits you. Have you ever been in that situation when you're going up against something you've never been in and that fear hits you? And it almost feels like you're paralyzed in your mind, in your soul, in your heart, in your spirit, physically. That fear hits you. And that's what was happening. You see, I believe this was the turning point for David and Saul's destinies. I believe that was a pivot point where Saul basically gave up his God-given authority and David took it over. It didn't manifest for a while, but right there when that fear crept in, because Saul fell into fear and intimidation, but David rose up strong in spirit. And God said, well, I'm going to have to let him carry on with this because you've just dropped the baton. There's many other things that happened, but I really believe that there was a defining moment for both. Amen? You see, fear and intimidation meant that Saul took his eyes off God's ability and put it on his ability. I'm going to say that again. Saul took his eyes off his or God's ability and tried to step it on what he could do in the natural. And that was impossible. And that's what fear often does. Fear will often come to you and say, you can't pay that bill. No, but God can. Fear will often come to you and say, you'll fail in that business because you don't have the right people. But God knows the right people. Come on. Fear, that was a defining moment. You see, fear clouded a sound mind in Saul. Fear actually got a hold of his mind and he's like, this is a guy that was ordained by a prophet, called as the first king. And he had done many great works. He had conquered many armies. But yeah, fear clouded his mind and gripped him. Look at another story. Matthew 14, 25 to 30. This is with the disciples and Jesus. He says there, now in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it's a ghost. And they cried out of fear. For fear. They cried out for fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, be of good cheer, it is I. Do not be afraid. In other words, get rid of fear. It's me. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it is you, command me to come on the water. So he said, come. You see, what he was doing, and I shared this last time with you. He gave a word. He gave a prophetic word. He gave his will. He illuminated the will for his life. He said, come. So how many of you ever had a word from God or a prophetic word or something? God shows you something. He leads you. Okay? That's his will. All you need to do is step out on that. Because when you step out on that word, that's where the power is. When you step out on a prophetic word, that's where the power is. That's where it says, do not forget those things that were prophesied that you'll be shipwrecked. In Hebrews. You see? When you step out on the word, there's power on the word. Because the word is life. It is Jesus Christ himself manifest. Amen? So look what he says. And Peter had come down out of the boat and walked on the water to Jesus. Yeah, he got out. He started. God speaks to you. He says, come. You step out on something you believe is of God. You start walking. You start going. It gets excited. There's a honeymoon period. But what happens? Things go wrong. Things go wrong. And guess what happens? You start taking your eyes off Jesus. You start taking your eyes off the word, the power. You stop speaking the word. And you start focusing on the issues, the things that aren't manifesting. And what happens? Fear starts to creep in and short circuits that word, and you begin to sink. Anytime you take your eyes off the word of God, anytime you take your eyes off what he's called you for, anytime you take your eyes off his ability, you begin to sink. And that's what happened here with these guys. See, fear can stop you from identifying. Listen, they couldn't even identify Jesus, the one that they walked with. What fear does is it clouds you and it stops you from even recognizing God doing something in your life. They couldn't identify the person they'd walked with for so long because fear crept in and they couldn't see what God was doing. And fear will do that to you. When fear comes and intimidation comes, you will not see God, you will not hear him properly, and you will not be able to recognize when he's trying to do something new in your life because your mind is troubled and tormented with fear. He will hold you back and you will miss God. You won't recognize him. You won't recognize the call that says, come. I told the Lord we're going to expose this thing today. People in this house won't have fear any longer. It's an exercise. You've got to work it. But when you bring it to light, it's exposed. And today I'm exposing it. And it's okay. I've gone through this. I've dealt with this thing. See, Jesus' word was the final authority. Come. Come. And you've got to step on this. This is the thing that is going to short-circuit fear in your life when you get this in here. And when this is in here and it starts to come out of here, guess what's going to happen? Fear will have no room. Fear will have no room. But it's got to get in here and it's got to come out of here. That's the only way you get rid of fear. And there's a difference. I just want to say, there's a difference between danger and fear. Okay? Don't go stand on the M1 with a sign that says, Jesus loves you, repent. You're going to meet him today. You're going home early, first class. You're going to go with the bugs. Okay? That's danger. That's stupid. Okay? But fear that torments you day and night when you lie in bed and you can't sleep because you're fearful. That fear that whenever something happens, your mind starts going, you can't think clearly. That's the spirit of fear that's trying to intimidate you and hold your mind and control you. Look at Elijah. I'm not even preaching my notes. You see, Jim said it. Elijah with Jezebel. This is a guy that took out the prophets of Baal. He had an anointing. He did many exploits. Okay? He hears one woman say, I'm going to kill you dead. I'm going to kill you dead until you're dead from it. I'm going to kill you some more. You're not waking up. Tomorrow you're dead. Okay? What happened? Spirit of intimidation. He can't think clearly. He starts running around like a lunatic. The angel actually has to say, let's have a grilled, go have a nap, and let's talk about this in the morning. Okay? He was clouded because of fear. He couldn't see properly. He couldn't think properly. See, fear is going to short-circuit the power and shut the flow. I'm going to say that again. Fear will short-circuit the power and shut the flow. The flow of provision, the flow of power, the flow of anointing, and the flow of favor in your life. That's what fear will shut down. So if you are lacking those things, go back and ask, do you walk around fearful? Are you tormented when you sleep at night? Are you unrested in your mind? Okay? Because that thing will shut down. It will shut down the provision. See, fear can distract you from the power source, Jesus. It can cause you to sink. It can cause you to sink. If you look at Job 3:25, it says, for this thing I greatly feared has come upon me, and that what I dreaded happened to me. I'm going to read again. For the thing I greatly feared has come upon me, and what I dreaded happened to me. That is Job. He was fearful of things happening. Guess what happened? It manifest. People ask why. Say why.
Why?
Because fear is Satan's faith. I'm going to say that again. Fear is Satan's faith. See, if faith is the only thing that pleases God, fear must be very unpleasing to God. So that means that's Satan's faith. He's got you because he short-circuited God's faith. Fear is Satan's faith. And he wants to short-circuit the faith of God in your life, the resurrection power. So he'll use fear to short-circuit it. And he's got you. Because now you're walking in unbelief, which is displeasing to God. That means he's getting straight to God's heart through you. And that's what he wants. He's not after you and me. He's after hurting the Father. But that's why he uses us, because we are so dearly loved. And I'm going to share some keys with you shortly. So fear is basically a spiritual cancer. Once you let it in, once you take it in, it spreads to every area of your life. I'm talking people that have a severe issue with fear. You will see that fear will penetrate every single area in one way or another. It might manifest differently, but it will start penetrating. Fear of death, fear of sickness, fear of flying, fear of swimming, fear of climbing on a motorcycle, fear of starting that business, fear of applying for a new job, fear of man, fear of insecurities even in leadership, okay? Fears to try new things, fears in relationships, fears of not having children, fear of rejection, fear of the future, fear of terrorism. It's just fear, fear, fear. When you listen, I just want to say this. Watch what you put in your heart. There's so much garbage out there. It's good to know what's going on. But if you follow what's going on more than you follow Jesus, and where the Spirit is moving and the time and season, guess what's going to happen? More fear is going to manifest. All you're doing is feeding that fire. That's all. Be aware of what's going on, but don't feed the fire. Feed your soul, as the song says, with this. Amen? Fear, 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 fear. Fear, 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 fear. That's Satan's key. He wants to short-circuit things. You see, fear, faith is the only thing that pleases God. Therefore, the only thing Satan loves is when you live by fear. Because then he can short-circuit everything God wants to give you. Look at all those stories. They were right there about to enter the promised land. Fear. Saul could have chopped Goliath's head off. He had enough people. If he had walked out and the anointing hit them, he would have done it. Fear. The disciples, they couldn't recognize God was doing something new. It clouded their judgment, clouded their discernment. Fear. And that's what it'll do to you. I have an acronym. There's two acronyms. The word fear stands for false evidence appearing real. False evidence appearing real. Or another one is false expectations appearing real. False expectations appearing real. In other words, have you ever seen a dog and put a light in a shadow? It looks bigger, but then when you look, it's just a little Jack Russell. Just, no, don't kick the dog. Okay. I saw the ladies over there. They were going to go home and kick a dog. Don't kick the dog. Okay? That's what fear does. It puts a spotlight and projects something, makes it look bigger than it is. And when you look at it, it's just a little speck on a lens in the shape of a demon. Take a cloth. Don't even anoint the camera. Just take a cloth and clean it. The speck will be gone. Amen? Hey, can I ask you just to put on that clip? I got a little clip I thought was pretty cool. You all awake still? Great.
Fear is not real. The only place that fear can exist is in our thoughts of the future. It is a product of our imagination, causing us to fear things that do not at present and may not ever exist. That is near insanity, Qatar. Now do not misunderstand me. Danger is very real, but fear is a choice. We are all telling ourselves a story. And that day mine changed.
You know what's so elegant about this little game, Jake? Nobody knows where the enemy is. They don't even know he exists.
You can either live your dreams or live your fears. And I think the majority of people actually are not living their dreams, but are living their fears. So I want to ask you a question. What are your fears? What are you afraid of? What are you scared of?
I wonder how we can approach this problem. Because this is a common problem in the world. Everyone, or I can say almost everyone, is frightened of something. Or it may be the fear of death, fear of loneliness, fear of not being loved, fear of not becoming famous, successful, or also fear of not having physical security, and fear of not having psychological security. There are so many multiple forms of fears. Now, to go into this problem really very deeply, can the mind and which includes the brain, be really, fundamentally, be free of fear.
The mind is the battleground. It is the place where the greatest conflict is. There are more people in this room having trouble in their mind than there are people having trouble in their finances. The struggle is in your mind. This is why we have people who go to bed tired and wake up tired. Slept 8 hours and you wake up still tired. The reason you wake up tired is that you got sleep but you didn't get rest. Your mind has been in turmoil all night long. You've been resting in your sleep. Have you ever woke up and your bed was wet? The bed is all torn, just like you've been in a fight, because your mind has not rested. Your body went to sleep, but your mind is still tied up in a warfare. Your mind is the battleground. Text somebody and tell them the enemy's after your mind. Out to worry you to death, out to stress you to death, out to break you down, out to make you quit, out to make you think that you can't get up.
He's in every one of their heads, and they trust him because they think they are him.
Don't you love the first part, the opening statement? Fear is not real. Fear is not real. Just let that settle in for a second. Fear is not real. It's in the mind, but it's not real on the outside. There's actually scientific study, and I can't remember the stats, but psychologists have stated that most fears, there's only like 3% or whatever the figure is that actually ever happen. 97% of everything somebody's ever feared in their life has never happened. So tell me this. How many of those 97 people have actually stepped out to live life in abundance because they've been bound by fear, which does not really exist? It's just the shadow of a dog barking, and his name is Satan. Amen? See, only place fear can exist is in the thoughts of the future. Fear doesn't exist now. Okay? That's a dangerous situation that exists now, and you've got to deal with it. But real fear is always about tomorrow, later, that conversation I have to have. Okay? That's where that fear starts rising up and nullifying what you've got to do, because it moves your focus off God. You see, fear, what it really is, it's a seed planted in your head, in your soil, by Satan. And it becomes a stronghold. Fear is a stronghold. And it's first planted as a seed in your thoughts. And it's a spirit that starts to play with you. It finds somewhere that it can get you. And when it gets you in one area, it starts to work around your life. And starts to say, let's put a bit of fear, yeah. Let's amplify the fear, yeah. Let's play a little bit, yeah. Let's play with these things. And that's what fear's job is to do. And I want to show you some keys today. Before I do, if you look at Joshua and Caleb for a second, he had a different spirit. He was able to silence doubt and unbelief immediately. And that's what you've got to be doing. Joshua and Caleb also declared, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the land. That was their declaration. That's why they were saying, we can do this, because he's behind us. Okay? The other thing is, Joshua and Caleb knew God was for them, because Caleb, if you remember, at one stage, he was about 80-something. He said, hey, God, I am not giving up what you promised me. I'm going to take it, my portion at least. I'm going in. So in other words, he was focused on what God had said and knew God was for him. And he was not going to let anything else hold that back from him. What about David? David ran with faith and testimony. What am I saying? He said, hey, I knew the lion. I've done the bear. What is this? What is this thing that stands before us? I will take him. And you know what the beautiful thing is? King Saul says, yeah, take the armor. He puts it on. He's like, I look like a clown. It's like, can you imagine? Like his pants hanging down, don't fit properly, buckles are loose. He's walking, he can barely walk with this thing. Okay? He's like rattling like a... Okay? So he says, no. I'm gifted. And he pulls out the slingshot. And he says, God has gifted me with this. This is all I need. Watch me do it with this. With him, the anointing. The anointing. And the gifting. And watch what God does. And that was David's attitude. What about Benaniah? Okay? Do you know everybody amplifies David about killing one giant? Do you know how many Benaniah, who was the captain of David's army, he killed two lion-like heroes. These were giants that had faces like lions, okay? These were scary dudes. He took on two. He killed actually a lion in a pit, okay? The other thing is he killed an Egyptian, a man of great height, 5 cubits tall. I said, Lord, how high is that? He said, get a converter. I said, okay. 5 cubits is 2.86 meters. I said, how big is that? He said, well, do it again. So 2.86 meters is 9 foot. I'm just around 8 foot, okay? So he has this dude standing there. He looks like a lion, okay? And take it one step further. He says, I've got a staff. He's got a spear. Guess what? He goes and takes the spear out of his hand and kills the dude with his spear. That's a different spirit. And that's the spirit we need. That's the spirit you and I need to walk into our destiny. See, 2 Corinthians 10, verse 2, it says, For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For our weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God, pulling down strongholds. Pulling down strongholds. Everyone say, pulling down strongholds. Casting down arguments. Don't let the devil argue in your head. Tell him what is written. That's what it's saying. And every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity in obedience in Christ. If you want to deal with fear, you're going to have to learn to take authority straight away when those thoughts come. When those fears come, you have to replace it with the Word of God immediately. It's no good just going sit in a corner meditating about it. Yeah, Pastor Shaun, but Joshua says meditate on my word day and night. Yes, and then speak it. Meditate on it to get your thinking right, but then speak it to let the enemy go and release the power of God in your life. That's the spoken word. I spoke on that. See, God is like a diamond. There's many facets. People take one thing and say it doesn't work. Yeah, but you forgot the other 14 sequences that need to go with it. Amen. We meditate. We speak. We believe. We have faith. We walk. We stand. We cry. But we have victory. Amen? Amen. See, fear is a spiritual weapon sent to hinder destiny. Fear is a stronghold. Doesn't matter what anyone says, it is a stronghold. And you need to bring that stronghold down. I declare today, according to 2 Timothy 1:7, you want to know how to bring it down? Do the angels want to know how to bring it down? Yes. Oh, thanks. So I got one person that wants to know. 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. That's the three keys to take the spirit of fear down in your life. Power, love, and a sound mind. Well, what does that look like, Shaun? I'm going to share it with you. Thank you for asking. Three things you need revelation of to overcome fear in your life. The power, you need to learn how to build yourself up in the power of the Holy Ghost. We heard about the person of the Holy Ghost. You need to learn to stir yourself up in the power of the Holy Ghost. That's one thing. Do you know every time we fly somewhere, Megan and myself, and we come into a different country, in the airwaves, I go into the bathroom and I take authority over every principality in that region because I'm the child of the Most High and I'm coming in. I take authority. I'm like, Lord, don't let the plane crash, but please. I take authority because you know what? Intimidation, when you move into different realms, there are different things that try and come against you. I take authority over any fears. If you go into any places that you don't know, I take authority over their fear. And I walk in the same anointing. Amen? Amen? The other thing is love. If you do not know the Father's love, you will always feel vulnerable. If you do not begin to know Him as Abba Father, Daddy God,
See, if you know a good daddy, a good Abba father, a good father, he will never want you to be hurt. He'll always provide for you. He'll always protect you, but he will discipline you. So if you don't get to know the love of the Father, you're missing a key ingredient to overcoming fear. Well, what does that mean? Great, you asked. I can't pay the bills. Fear starts settling in. No, when I know the love of my Father, he will never leave me. Yeah, but you were an idiot. You made a mistake. You did things stupid with your money. Great, he still loves you enough to fix you. Yeah. Amen? Or fear of death, fear of motorcycle. You know what? I declare angels when I climb on my bike. I don't fear anything. It's a chariot of fire. Get out the way or get burnt. I declare angels. And guess what? If it's my time, I'll get the coffee ready. You see, you can't let fear paralyze you because you won't enjoy life. You won't do things for God. But I know when I climb on there, my daddy has training wheels on my bike. And he's walking beside me. Well, running beside me. You've got to know the Father's love to overcome fear. You've got to build yourself up in the Spirit to be charged up and wound up to overcome that Spirit. You've got to know Him as Abba Father. You'll never leave me nor forsake me. You're with me all the time. What is this giant that stands before me? What is this litigation that comes against me? What is this man that rises up against me? If you are for me, who can be against me? Because you love me and you're backing me and all of heaven. We need to know the Father's love and walk in it. Walk in it and receive it. The other thing is a sound mind. If we do not take our thoughts captive and bring down anything that exalts itself above God, what does that mean? Well, let me find it for you. I wrote it down here. If God says, I will provide for you according to my riches, and something comes against you in thought saying, hey, you're not going to have enough for this month, it's exalting itself above what this is. That's anything that exalts itself above the Word of God. And I've got to bring every one of those demon thoughts in captive and align with this. Because this says, I will meet every need. I will protect you. Angels will fly with you. Supernatural favor will open doors. Because I'm with you. And I know the beginning from the end, so you don't have to worry about anything. Those are three key ingredients that we need to overcome the Spirit. You want a band to come up? Thanks. See, when you begin to know who you are, your identity, okay? When you know whose you are, I'm going to say it again. When you know whose you are, fear has no reign in your life. David knew, hey, hold on. Let me look at this. I've done the bear, done the lion. I've seen him before. He's called me. He's with me. At a young age, he knew him. Saul forgot whose he was, and fear took over. The disciples forgot who they walked with, and they couldn't see properly. Their judgment was clouded. I don't know where the Lord's leading me. I don't want to look at my nose anymore. I actually haven't much. He's given you a spirit of love, power, and a sound mind. Love, power, and a sound mind. See, Jude 1 says, stir yourself up, pray in the Holy Ghost, building yourself up in the most holy faith. Are you tongue-talking bunch? Hey, we're a powerful bunch. I'm charged up. Touch me, you might get shocked. Okay? The Word says, stir yourself up. It also says that when you come with supplications unto the Lord, that's where our power is, when we have an intimacy relationship with Him. Amen? And you've got to know Him as Abba Father. You know, the challenge is, when I grew up, I didn't have a good relationship. Well, let me rephrase it. I had a good relationship with my dad, but it was quite a far distance. It was like from here to South Australia. Saw him twice a year. Okay? But you know, when I got saved, I didn't really know Abba Father. I knew the God that everyone preached from the Old Testament that wants to hit you with a rod. If you step out of line, He's going to kneecap you. Okay? But only, you know, when I started walking in freedom and power and anointing, when I started knowing Him as Abba Father, my daddy. Because when I mess up, I go sit on his lap. Dad, I messed up. It's like, okay, I knew you would mess up. That's why I sent my son. So tell me something new. Can't tell you anything new. He says, good, so just keep walking. Love, power, and a sound mind. We are to renew our minds according to the Word of God. If we are not renewing and aligning our thoughts with His thoughts, my mind is one with Christ. Fear will always rule and reign. The only way we deal with the Spirit is taking all three keys and activating it in our lives and walking in it. And sometimes we find that we can't receive love from people because we can't give love. You ever been around people that, you know, I love telling guys I love you just to mess with them. You see their responses. Don't get it back in a text. No. Yeah. Knuckles. But you know what? If you don't have the love of God flowing through you, it's because you're not connected to His love. And you want to know it, but you just don't know it. But we want to know it. We need to plug into the love of God, the power of God, okay, to be able to flow, to overcome the spirit of fear. I have not given you, HFCC, a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and of a sound mind. And that is my declaration over you today. I just want to pray, even you on live stream, just while every head is bowed, firstly, to know Abba Father, you need to know the Son, Jesus Christ. There are not many roads to heaven. There are not many roads to a peace. Even motivation alone will not give you that peace. So the first prayer I want to ask, if you do not know Jesus Christ as Lord, or you feel you've backslidden and you just want to come back like the prodigal child and run back into His arms, I just want you to put up your hands quickly. I'm not going to call you up. I just want to pray for you. Thank you, brother. See you. I just want you to repeat after me, everybody, even you at live stream at home. Father, Lord, forgive me. Lord, if I've moved away from You or didn't know You, I ask today that You open up Your arms and receive me. And Lord, above all things, that You give me this revelation of the love of the Father. And I thank You today. I'm washed and cleansed through the blood on Calvary in Jesus' name. I also want to pray a declaration. I want to pray a declaration over you, and I want you to pray out loud after me. Father, forgive me. Forgive me for allowing fear to rule and reign in my life. No longer will I fear. No longer will fear replace faith in my life. As of today, I choose to, through the grace of God and prompting of the person of the Holy Spirit, open up to the love of God. Draw near to you. Stir my faith. And live out of the testimonies I already have. I choose to become expectant for you to show up in every area of my life. I declare, the Lord is the light of my life and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? You created me. You formed me. I no longer give place to fear. You have redeemed me. You have called me by my name. I am yours. Though at times I walk through the troubles, tests and trials, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. You comfort me and guide me daily. I do not fear those who kill body, but they cannot kill soul. But rather I fear him who is able to destroy both. I receive your peace. My mind is still. My faith is stirred. The armor of God is on me. The blood of Jesus covers every area of my life. You care for me. Every little detail of my life. You will never leave me nor forsake me. As of today, I am free from fear. Fear is brought to light. I have repented and received your forgiveness. I'm no longer condemned. All fear that was in my life is now on the cross. Fear, I rebuke you and denounce you. No longer is my heart troubled. No longer will I be afraid in Jesus' name. Did you have something? Give them the mic real quick.
If you feel that the Lord has released you to go and have some fellowship, that's fine. If you feel you need prayer, I'll be hanging around, or Dad or someone will be here. But otherwise, if you just want to worship a little bit, just feel how the Lord is leading you. Amen. But otherwise, have a blessed day. Have a blessed week. We love you. We appreciate you. In Jesus' name.
Hi, everybody. It's been a great service. I want to thank you for joining us. I'd like to take this time to say thanks once again. Maybe you'd want to become a part of that family of the Lord Jesus Christ, our family. Not about joining a church, it's about joining a family that goes beyond all sorts of boundaries and barriers. You need to be able to say that simple prayer with us. If you'd like to follow me, you say, Jesus, come into my life. Take hold of me, lead me, guide me. Father, thank you for sending Jesus to take my place on the cross and in hell, and so that I may live a life that is pleasing unto you. Thank you, Father, for sending Jesus. Holy Spirit, come in and empower me to live a life that will be pleasing to God. I want to thank you for saying that prayer and joining our family. We'd love to be in contact with you. If you would respond to the details on the website via email or phone, we'd love to be able to send some resources to you. God bless.